Good afternoon, welcome. I'm sorry that y'all's coming to Washington was greeted with such lousy weather. We've got a blizzard, it's so cold outside. I actually saw walking over a politician, it was so cold he had his hands in his own pockets. And that means it's cold outside. So I'm thrilled to be here in a room full of Texas farmers and ranchers. I'm thrilled to welcome y'all here. These are extraordinary times. They're a little bit crazy. If you don't like the news any given minute, give it a few minutes, it'll change. But despite all the craziness, I think we're getting a remarkable amount done. And that has been incredibly encouraging to see us delivering real results to the men and women who elected. You know, one of the biggest things the past year that Texas dealt with was the aftermath of Hurricane Harvey. Harvey did devastating damage to our state. Damage that ran from Corpus Christi all the way up to Louisiana, 250 miles of the Gulf Coast. Did significant damage to cotton farmers down in South Texas, to homes, to businesses. And I'll tell you, even as that storm was still in the Gulf, even as it was starting to hit Texas, we saw Texans come together and rise up and stand together in a way that was inspiring. As Texans united and stood as one. I think the story of Hurricane Harvey will always be the thousands of ordinary Texans that went out in boats and began rescuing their neighbors. Rednecks and bastards. Very best of Texas. And I think it conveyed the spirit of who we are as a state. Nobody sat around and waited for someone else to tell them what to do. They just said, there's a problem, I'm going to step out and help. Remember talking with one fellow in South Texas who went out in a helicopter, was rescuing cattle. He described jumping off a helicopter into the water of the flooding to pull a young calf out of a fence where he'd gotten tied up in. Over and over and over again, we just saw heroes stepping up. And we also saw in Washington, despite the incredible partisan division that exists on almost every other issue, we saw a degree of unity among the Texas congressional delegation that was powerful, giving relief for the state. You know, I remember the week after the hurricane, I was invited to address the Houston City Council along with Sheila Jackson Lee. Now, Sheila and I reeled just about everything. As we both told the City Council that day, we said, listen, on any other day, there may be a host of issues that divide us. But today, we're all Texans. We're all standing as one. And one of the city council members observed, it so happened that Sheila was wearing red and I was wearing blue. And when that was pointed out, that both of us proceeded to hug each other, which may have simultaneously ended both our political groups. But we saw in Washington the delegation come together and lead and produce real results. We saw a total of three major hurricane relief bills come through Congress. The first one that passed within weeks of the hurricane hitting came out of the House of Representatives at $7.5 billion. I joined with John Cornyn here in the Senate. We doubled that to $15.25 billion. That passed and provided the first tranche of relief to Texas. Billions of dollars on the ground within days of the disaster strike. The second tranche was over $30 billion directed primarily at flood insurance at the funds that had been heavily tapped by all the people who had flooded. Then, tax relief legislation passed, targeted at the hurricane. That's legislation I took the lead on in the Senate. I joined with John Cornyn, Marco Rubio introducing it, and the House, Kevin Brady carried it. It was legislation targeted to those who had been impacted by Hurricane Harvey. So it provided four things. Number one, that if your home had been damaged, you could deduct those damages, those property casualty damages, on your taxes without being subject to the ordinary limitations on those deductions. Number two, it provided that if your home was damaged, you could make withdrawals from your retirement savings, your IRA or your 401k, to rebuild your home without having to pay a 10% early withdrawal. Number three, it incentivized people nationwide to contribute to charities that were engaged in hurricane relief and exempted those contributions from the ordinary limits on both individual and corporate contributions to charities. And number four, for the thousands of employers in Texas who kept paying their employees, even though the place of work was under work, the water, even though they couldn't come in and work, they kept the paychecks coming anyway and provided a tax credit to those employers for keeping the paycheck coming. All told, the Cruz, Cornyn, and Rubio tax relief legislation provided roughly $6 billion in relief to those impacted by Harvey and Irma and Maria, and passed both houses of Congress with signed into law. And then we had the last, the biggest of the disaster relief bills that just recently passed. It came out of the House of Representatives at $81 million. And once again, John Cornyn and I teamed up to improve the bill. We increased it from $81 billion to $89 billion. And we changed the formula so that Texas would get a much, much bigger share of that pot. Given that, Hurricane Harvey is, by most estimates, one of the two most damaging natural disasters in U.S. history, it was only fair that Texas residents get the relief they're entitled to. So we changed the formulas so that money would flow to Texas. We increased funding for the Army Corps of Engineers by 50% from $10 billion to $15 billion for long-term flood mitigation projects, for things like potentially constructing a third reservoir in the Houston area, which could have saved the flooding of thousands of homes. That bill, in addition, had $2.3 billion in agricultural relief for crops and livestock that were damaged by Harvey and Irma and Maria. That was critical for all the agricultural damage we suffered in Texas. That was included in that bill as well. And then we also had the seed cotton fix, something that I had fought hard for. Cotton for too long had been unfairly excluded and not treated on a level playing field with other crops. That was included in the disaster relief bill as well, and we just got that passed. On all of those, I was proud to work closely with the Farm Bureau in getting those done. Those were real priorities, and it was touch and go making it happen, but we got them done. That was an amazing example, I think, of Texans, of the Texas congressional delegation standing as one united. Now, aside from dealing with the hurricane, we've also had an incredibly momentous year. In my view, the four big priorities for the President and the new Congress in 2017 and 2018, the four big priorities were tax reform, regulatory reform, Obamacare, and judges. And my view was if we could deliver on those four, it would have a long-lasting, powerful impact on the country. And if we failed to deliver on those four, it would be one of the most heartbreaking missed opportunities of our life. For much of last year, it wasn't clear which one of those it would be. There were an awful lot of times where I'm sure y'all were frustrated. I was certainly frustrated watching Republicans run around like chickens with their head cut and not manage to come together and deliver on what we promised. But then as the year came to a close, a remarkable thing happened. We saw Republicans come together as one, and we began to deliver on each of those four major promises. Tax reform. In December, we passed historic tax cuts. A tax cut package that has already resulted in tremendous benefits. Over 4 million Americans have gotten pay raises or bonuses as a direct result of those tax cuts. Those tax cuts on the business side, on the corporate side, we went from having the highest corporate income tax rate in the developed world, 35%. Virtually all of Europe had a lower rate than we. United Kingdom, Germany, France, all had lower. Ireland's 12.5%. We're at 35, they're at 12.5, and we have been seeing U.S. businesses fleeing America and moving overseas and taking jobs with them. Well, in the tax reform bill, we cut that rate from 35% down to 21%. And we cut the rates also for small businesses and pass-throughs, including allowing immediate expensing of capital expenditure, something that is designed to produce enormous benefit, particularly for farmers and ranchers, the ability to immediately expense. If you buy a new tractor, if you buy new equipment, you no longer have to depreciate it over a number of years. You can expense it right now. That has a powerfully pro-growth impact on taxes. On the death tax, my hope had been that we would repeal it altogether. That's what I thought hard to do. At the end of the day, we didn't have the votes to do that, but we did end up doubling the exemptions from the death tax, which means now that 2/3 of the estates that would have been included by the death tax are now exempted from it. So it was major improvements on the death tax, which obviously is impacting farmers and ranchers and small business owners all across the country. We saw individual tax rates lowered across the board, every income tax level going down. We saw the standard deduction double from $12,000 a couple to $24,000 a couple, which means starting next year, 90% of taxpayers will be able to fill out their taxes on a postcard. Now, personally, I think that should be 100%. I think we should have a simple flat tax, and we should abolish the IRS. But 90% is a big deal. That's a big step in the right direction for 90% of Americans to be able to fill out their taxes on a postcard. We also saw the child tax credit doubled from $1,000 per child per year to $2,000 per child per year. That's an enormous benefit to working families across this country who are struggling to make ends meet. And I'll tell you, as part of tax reform, we also saw big, big conservative victories. Two in particular that I was very involved in. Number one, as part of tax reform, we repealed the Obamacare individual mandate. That's another big deal. I got to tell you, it was back in October that I and a handful of other conservatives began urging the conference, let's repeal the individual mandate, let's do this as part of tax reform. And when we started doing that, we had virtually no support in the conference. We maybe had a half dozen senators supporting us. Virtually all of our colleagues were saying, look, we made a couple of runs at this already. We couldn't get it done. Let's not muck up tax reform by bringing Obamacare. And so we began making the case, both publicly and privately, that getting rid of the individual mandate was the right thing to do. Individual mandate is every year the IRS fines about 6.5 million Americans because they can't afford health insurance. Of those, roughly 1 million of them are in Texas. Roughly 40%, roughly 80% earn $50,000 a year or less, and roughly 40% earn $25,000 a year or less. So think about it for a minute. You're a single mom. You're working hard to make ends meet. You're not even making $25,000 a year. You can't afford health insurance because premiums have skyrocketed under Obamacare. And to add insult to injury, the IRS comes along and fines you because you can't afford health insurance. One of the things that led Bill Clinton to call Obamacare craziest thing in the world. About the only time I ever agreed with Bill Clinton. Well, we made the case that repealing the mandate is providing real and meaningful tax relief to those 6.5 million people getting fined by the IRS. But not only that, the Congressional Budget Office scored it as saving over $300 billion, which we argued, let's take all that money and put it on the individual side. That's what paid for lowering the rates across the board. That's what paid for doubling the child tax credit. And we went from, in October, having maybe 6 or 7 senators supporting us, to in December, all 52 Republicans coming together and voting to repeal the Obamacare individual mandate. That was a big, big victory that just a few months ago, nobody thought we could achieve. There's another big victory as part of tax reform, which is an amendment I introduced on school choice, on expanding the options for parents in education. And it focused on college 529 savings plans. 529 savings plans are immensely popular. They allow parents and grandparents to save in a tax-advantaged way to pay for college expenses of their kids and grandkids. Roughly 13 million Americans use 529 savings plans right now. The amendment I introduced expanded those savings plans so that they cover not just college, but so that parents can also spend it on K-12 education, can use those tax-advantaged funds to pay for public school, private school, parochial school, religious school, whatever the parent chooses, up to $10,000 per child per year. Now, when that amendment came up, there was some drama on the Senate floor. It came up after midnight on Friday, early Saturday morning. It's clear it was going to be a close vote. We had 52 Republicans. We lost first one, and then we lost two Republicans. When the second Republican voted no, Senate floor staff picked up the phone. They called the Vice President. The Vice President was at his residence. Said, "Mr. Vice President, looks like we may have a tied vote. We may need your vote." So the Vice President went and got the motorcade, started heading down the Capitol. I'm standing there talking to one of the two Republicans who had voted no, trying to convince her to switch her vote. While I'm doing that, behind me comes Joe Manchin, Democrat from West Virginia. He walks down and votes yes. There's an audible gasp in the Weldon Senate. Senate floor staff picks up the phone. They call the Vice President's office and said, "Mr. Vice President, we just got Manchin. It looks like we don't need your vote." So the motorcade turned around and started heading back. Manchin goes to his desk, sits down, and a sea of Democrats descend. They begin yelling at him. I'm pretty sure they pulled out a stick and just began whacking him. And about 5 minutes later, Manchin sheepishly walks down to the front and shifts his vote to another. So the Senate floor staff picked up the phone and called the Vice President's office again. Said, "Mr. Vice President, we need your vote after all." He turned the motorcade around a second time. It takes about 15 minutes to get from the Naval Observatory to the Capitol. 15 minutes later, the Vice President walked onto the floor of the Senate, said, "The ayes being 50, the nays being 50, the Senate being equally divided, the presiding officer votes in the affirmative, the amendment is adopted." And with that, we passed the most far-reaching and significant federal school choice legislation in the history of Congress. That was a major, major victory for up to 50 million school kids all across the country, allowing parents and grandparents to save in a tax-advantaged way to help with the education of their kids and grandkids. So on tax reform, Republicans came together and delivered in a big way. How about regulatory reform? Reg reform, I think, has been one of the greatest and most unheralded victories of this administration and this Congress. Agency after agency after agency, we've seen reducing regulations. You know, I'm reminded of years ago, I was out in West Texas, and I asked folks there, I said, "What's the difference between regulators and locusts?" I said, "Well, the thing is, you can't use pesticide on the regulators." And this old West Texas farmer leaned forward and said, "Want to bet?" But we have seen a change in regulatory environment where all across the state, I'm hearing from Texas farmers, from ranchers, from small businesses, that the regulators no longer are treating you like the enemy. No longer are trying to crush you. And that has resulted in Texans being far more optimistic, investing more capital, hiring more jobs, expanding their operations. It's been important, you know, one thing that I worked with the Farm Bureau on is the FEMA tip, where we had issues with the Department of Interior not being willing to work cooperatively to address and deal with that. And I was pleased to go and work closely with Secretary Zinke in helping bring together Texas ranchers with the Interior Department to say, "Look, we've got a common goal of eradicating the FEMA tip and not seeing it spread." That's an example of a markedly different regulatory environment than we had 15 months ago. We've seen the administration step in and halt the waters of the United States rule. A rule that, as you know, would have had enormous negative consequences on farmers and ranchers. A rule that basically defined almost any puddle or ditch as navigable waters, subjecting your farms and ranches to EPA regulation and control. Of course, navigable is the statutory term, and when they're calling a puddle navigable, I'm reminded of a line from my favorite movie, The Princess Bride, which is, you keep on using that word. I do not think it means what you think it means. And we saw the administration stepping forward to stop that rule. That's another example where on reg reform we're seeing big, big victories. Third big priority, Obamacare, remains the biggest unfinished promise that Congress and the administration have. But it's worth noting we got a big victory in repealing the individual mandate. Now we need to finish the job, and I'll tell you, I'm committed. I'm continuing to roll up my sleeves and work to try to bring 50 Republicans together, get us all on the same page, deliver on our promise to repeal Obamacare, to lower health insurance premiums, to give consumers more choice, more competition, more options, more freedom. And then finally, judges. Judges has been another enormous victory of the last 15 months. We have Neil Gorsuch on the Supreme Court, who is an absolute home run for all of us who value and cherish the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, for all of us who care about the First Amendment, about free speech and religious liberty, for all of us who value the Second Amendment and our right to keep and bear arms. The judges are at the crossroads of either protecting or undermining those. And not only do we have a terrific new Supreme Court justice, but last year, the Senate confirmed 12 Federal Court of Appeals judges, which is the most Court of Appeals judges ever confirmed in the first year of a president's term. Obama, in his first year, had 4. We did 12, including 2 from Texas on the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, both of whom are strong, principled constitutionalists. So I'm confident we can count on to defend our rights. So as I look back on where we are in the first year and 3 months, I think on each of the major priorities we've been able to come together and deliver, going forward, what I'm urging my colleagues to do is we need to keep delivering on our promises. Keep reducing taxes, keep reducing regulations, keep creating an environment that grows jobs, grows small businesses, allows farmers and ranchers to grow your operations and prosper. And I give you my word, that's what I'm focused on doing each and every day. The number one priority of Texans in every part of our state is jobs, 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 and that's my top priority as well. And so it is a privilege to represent you.
Problem on some of our farms and ranches, I think, speak for a lot of people in here, is it costs us a lot of money for health insurance.
Yep.
You mentioned it, but it is a huge, huge deal.
I know it is, and I'll tell you, just yesterday I sat down with 5 other senators continuing to work to try to finish the job on Obamacare, trying to get us to 50. We've got a narrow 51 vote majority. It is swirly. But I'm trying to get everyone, all right, where do we have common ground to lift the burdens of our failed health insurance system? One of the things you mentioned that I ought to address is trade, because I know it's something folks here are worried about. I'm worried about it as well. It's the most consistent concern I hear from the business community, from the agricultural community, is what's going to happen on trade. We're in the midst of NAFTA renegotiations. My view is NAFTA renegotiations, well, that could be a good thing or bad thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Look, NAFTA's over 20 years old. Modernizing and updating the agreement could be a good thing. If we are expanding access to the Mexican and Canadian markets, if we're opening up markets and expanding trade, that would be a good thing. On the other hand, if we're erecting barriers to U.S. markets and decreasing trade, that's a bad thing, and that'll hurt Texas, and it'll hurt agriculture. Now, within the administration, I think, frankly, there are conflicting voices. There are voices pulling in both directions. I can tell you what my voice is saying, both publicly and privately, is that I'm urging the president, the vice president, the chief of staff, the commerce secretary, the U.S. trade representative, all of them, I'm making the case, let's open up markets, let's not shut down markets. NAFTA is important. I'll tell you, in the last month, I've had at least five conversations with the president of the White House about the importance of maintaining NAFTA. In fact, I've heard, I think, the greatest opportunity for NAFTA expansion is the energy markets in Mexico, where they have enormous energy resources, natural gas and oil, not being fully developed right now because of their legal and political circumstances. If we open that up and put that in NAFTA, that'll produce thousands of high-paying jobs in Mexico, and naturally the place they'll go for expertise will be Texas. That'll produce thousands of high-paying jobs in Texas. That's a win-win for everyone. There are voices in the administration, though, that are skeptics of trade. Everyone's seen the steel tariffs and aluminum tariffs. There may be more to come on that. Now, I am encouraged that since those tariffs were announced, that a whole number of countries have been exempted from those tariffs, and so the sphere to which they apply has shrunk quite a bit. That's a good thing. And actually, just today, I sent a letter to the president, joined by two other senators, making an argument for here's something we can do on NAFTA that would be positive. Let's use NAFTA as a vehicle for regulatory reform. In particular, let's add a new competitiveness chapter to NAFTA, which you don't even need to negotiate with Canada and Mexico. You can do it unilaterally as an annex. And let's use it to codify regulatory reform. Take, for example, something like the RAINS Act. The RAINS Act, something I'm an original co-sponsor of, says that any federal economic regulation that would impose $100 million or more of harm on the economy can't go into effect without an affirmative up-down rule vote of Congress. So, for example, the Waters of the United States rule would never have gone into effect because it would have required Congress to vote. RAINS Act would be the most far-reaching structural regulatory reform we've ever passed. Now, if we took it up under regular order, it would never pass because the Democrats would filibuster. What I've urged the president to do is attach the RAINS Act to NAFTA, send it to Congress, and under Trade Promotion Authority, that gets fast-tracked for a straight up-down vote on a 50-vote threshold that can't be filibustered. And so that has a double advantage. Number one, if you combine something really meaningful regular form with the tax cut we saw last year, the impact in terms of jobs and economic growth would be immense. But number two, it's my hope that in doing that, that will draw the energy on NAFTA renegotiation towards positive things that are producing jobs, that are expanding markets, and away from more negative directions. But if you're concerned about trade, I am too. And your voices need to continue to be heard, and I can promise you my voice will continue to be heard as well. And I'll mention, I see we just, my friend Kevin Brady just walked in, who he and I worked very, very closely together on all of the Hurricane Harvey matters. Worked very, very closely. He was the lead author in the House of the Hurricane Tax Relief Bill. I was the lead author in the Senate. And I would note, I was thrilled to see, just last week, Kevin and I were both at the Houston Astros celebration at the White House.
And thanks for your leadership on tax reform.
I thought you were going to say thanks for delivering the World Series champion.
Thank you.
But I was in particular very pleased to see Kevin publicly make some news calling for actually a bill I've introduced in the Senate, which is to make all the individual tax cuts permanent. We need to bring it up and vote on it. You know, a little bit of the backstory: the week after tax reform, Bernie Sanders was on TV, he was on CNN, Jake Tapper. And Jake asked him, said, look, Bernie, this tax cut cuts taxes for millions of working men and women. Isn't that a good thing? And Bernie says, yes, it's a very good thing. The problem is it isn't permanent. So I saw that. I immediately took the clip and tweeted it out to the world. Said, Bernie, I agree with you. I've drafted legislation to make all the individual tax cuts permanent. Join me, let's get it passed. We can get it done in days. I'm confident we're going to vote on that in the Senate. We're going to vote on it in the House, and it'll be an interesting choice for everyone to decide. Do you want the individual tax cuts permanent or not? I certainly know my answer, and I hope everyone's answer is the same, which is let's